Varsha, dignitaries in the audience and friends. I welcome you all to this lecture meeting on stamp duty including business restructuring. Friends, I have fortunately gone through the presentation of Anup Bhai. There are about 72 slides and I would not like to take any of your time, and I straight away request Jagdish Bhai to introduce the Ashok Bhai to introduce the speaker and take the proceedings further. Thank you.
Mr. President, respected seniors and friends, today we have fortunate enough to have Mr. Anup as the speaker. As far as the topic is concerned, friends, when a transaction is being entered into by us to attract professional, immediately we think of tax consequences and how that can be minimized. But the lawyers, when he always thinks of the how to save the stamp duty. Friends, the topic for today's discussion is gaining importance for us tax practitioners and advisors on income tax matters. Incidence of stamp duty as a cost is also quite high, and therefore it is certainly worth the effort to save it. We have provisions of Section 50C, 43CA, 56(2), 7B, etc. Stamp duty valuation affects us in day-to-day practice as well. We are confronted with stamp duty implication on purchase, sale of immovable properties, leave and license transaction, redevelopment of society transactions, conversion of tenancy into ownership, etc. Friends, here I would like to just raise two simple issues for Anup's consideration, two practical issues. One is, always talks about when the builder issues a allotment letter, whether stamp duty is payable, or if subsequently on agreement to sale, if it is paid, whether it is sufficient compliance, whether on allotment letter it is payable or not. Secondly, friends, as regards partnership, as we know, maximum stamp duty on partnership deed is 5,000 rupees. Of course, it depends on the capital contribution. I am told if once we pay 5,000 rupees, then subsequent deeds can be prepared on the stamp paper of rupees 500. But my question for Anup's consideration, he said there are four partners, two partners retired, and now there is a new partnership between the two partners. Whether stamp duty is payable, again on 5 rupees is sufficient, 500 rupees is sufficient, or again it used to be prepared on 5,000 rupees stamp paper. Friends, this question I am discussing with very many people, but today I could not get the proper answer. Today I would like to have the views of Mr. Anup. As far as Anup is concerned, friends, I can say only in one word, Lahan Murti Lahan Kirti Mahan. With this, I request Jagdish Punjabi to formally introduce Anup.
Good evening, friends. Sharma ji has already described Anup, so I do not know whether any further formal introduction is required, but be that as it may. Anup is a source of inspiration. A look at his CV reveals that he is a fellow member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, having secured rank in both inter as well as final CA. Apart from his CA, he is also a law graduate. He has also done business consultancy studies from Jamnalal Bajaj Institute. He is a partner of Praveen P. Shah and Company, Chartered Accountants, and has hands-on experience in business restructuring, capital market regulations, foreign investments, international tax, PE investments, real estate structuring, valuations, etc. He has authored several books which have run into several editions, prominent amongst them being Handbook on Capital Market Regulations, Wills and Successions, Family Settlements, published by ICA, Laws and Business, published by BCA, and Income Tax Advisor. He has contributed over 160 articles to several publications. He has been awarded a best feature in BCA journal, and he has been awarded a prize for outstanding research paper on FDI issues and problems. He has given talks at several seminars and workshops across India. He is a director, independent director and member of audit committee of several companies. He is a member of National Committee of Financial Markets of CII, member of Direct Tax Committee of IMC. He is a convener of the editorial board and the general committee of BCA, and he is a member of the International Tax Committee of the Chamber of Tax Consultants. Now, with this background, before I request Anup to speak, may I request the President to hand over a memento to him as a mark of our love and affection.
Good evening, friends. In the next hour and a half, time permitting, I intend to cover the entire 72 slides which I have laid out before you, because stamp duty is something so vast that 72 is even a small number to be covering it. If you recall, in finance terms, we have the rule of 72. Anything, if you divide 72 by the number of years, that is the rate at which, you know, interest compounds. Or if you divide it by the rate, then that is the number of period in which you will get double your income. So if you say 6%, so 72 divided by 6 in 12 years, you'll get double of what you've invested. So similarly here, 72 divided by 1.5, hopefully you get double the value for the time which you would be investing in this. Stamp duty, friends, as you would all appreciate, is becoming one of the biggest roadblocks to deal making, both in the real estate sector and in business restructuring. So today I intend to cover both the real estate sector stamp duty as well as business restructuring. A very interesting comment made by our Honorable Prime Minister, and that's a comment made by him. This isn't my words being attributed to him. Reduce stamp duty to limit black money in the real estate sector. And this is a comment made by him at a forum of international investors, where he accepted that stamp duty is one of the impediments to reducing black money in this country. Second, stamp duty is a big obstacle to cleaning up the mess in the real estate sector. So both the statements carry a lot of weightage, and they show the importance which even the Prime Minister ascribes to stamp duty. Unfortunately, as we will see, stamp duty being somewhat of a state subject, somewhat of a central subject, it often falls within the cracks and nobody takes responsibility and states get away with what they want to do. A marginal reduction has been made in the stamp duty rates owing to pressure from the center under the Jawaharlal Nehru Urban Renewal Mission, where they said if you want funding under the JNURM, please reduce stamp duty or else we are not going to fund your infrastructure projects. So they have done that in many cases, including in Maharashtra, but they have more than compensated it by the exponential increase in the Reddy Reckoner rate, in the circle rate, the guideline or the Jantri valuation. These are different names given to the same beast by different states. In Ahmedabad, it is known as Jantri. In Maharashtra, it is known as Reckoner. In Tamil Nadu, you call it guideline. Somewhere else, you call it circle. Two basic principles from Shakespeare, which are very relevant when you look at stamp duty law. And if you keep them in mind, you'll never be unhappy. There's many a slip between the cup and the lip. So what appears on paper never appears in reality. I may tell you something, this is the correct legal position, but when you go to register a document, it is never the correct legal position because the registrar has his own view. What the right hand giveth, the left hand take it back. So what is given by way of reduce in stamp duty rates is often taken back by increase in the Reckoner rates or by changing the valuation principles. So if you follow these two principles, you will never be unhappy when you encounter stamp duty law, because then you know what you are encountering. If you look at the stamp duty as a source of revenue for the Maharashtra government, it is the second highest source of revenue after value-added tax. Exponential growth from 8,200 crores in 2009 to 17,000 crores in 12-13. A compounded annual growth rate of over 20% in 4 years, something which neither the Nifty nor the Sensex delivers. Stamp duty delivers year on year 20% for the Maharashtra government. If you stretch this and you take it back another 10-15 years, yet you would have 15 to 17% CAGR, which everybody would appreciate is an excellent growth rate. Now, often when you look at stamp duty, you get confused. There's the Indian Stamp Act, there is the Bombay Stamp Act of 1958, now known as the Maharashtra Stamp Act, because the government came out with a change in all the short titles, so now it is known as the Maharashtra Stamp Act. Which act applies? So for the answer to that, you need to go back to the Constitution of India, to the 7th schedule. There is entry 91 in list 1, which is the union list. and entry 63 in list 2, which is the state list. The Indian Stamp Act of 1899 applies to the whole of India except Jammu and Kashmir, and the Maharashtra Stamp Act of 1958 overrides the Indian Stamp Act in Maharashtra for about 63 instruments which are covered by it. 9 instruments are yet governed by the Indian Stamp Act. So for 63 instruments, look at the Maharashtra Stamp Act. For the balance 9 instruments, look at the Indian Stamp Act. The Schedule 1 to the Maharashtra Stamp Act and the Indian Stamp Act contain different rates of stamp duty for different instruments which have been laid down both under the Maharashtra Stamp Act and the Indian Stamp Act. Just like Maharashtra, we have some other states also which have come out with their own Stamp Act. So you have the Gujarat Stamp Act, Rajasthan, Karnataka, Kerala, and the latest in 2010 was the Uttar Pradesh Stamp Act. So these states have come out with their own Stamp Act. However, 9 articles are yet governed by the Indian Stamp Act even in these states, because those are governed in Entry 91, that is Union List, and the state has no constitutional power to enact stamp duty on these instruments. Next question, and a very basic and a fundamental question: is stamp duty leviable on a transaction? The answer is a clear-cut no. Stamp duty is always on an instrument, never on a transaction. You don't say a merger attracts stamp duty. You say a merger scheme attracts stamp duty. You don't say a flat purchase attracts stamp duty. You say a conveyance or an agreement to sale attracts stamp duty. So never a transaction, always an instrument. If no instrument, no stamp duty. If an instrument, check whether any of the articles under the Maharashtra Stamp Act or the 9 under the Indian Stamp Act contain a provision taxing that. If yes, tax. If no, again no tax. And the law on this is very well settled by Section 3 of the MSA, that is the Maharashtra Stamp Act, as well as several decisions like Maharashtra Sugar Mills and Hindustan Lever Supreme Court, that it is always the instrument which attracts stamp duty, never the transaction. Now then, we come to the next important feature. Once we say it is an instrument which attracts stamp duty, what do you mean by an instrument? And Section 2 of the Maharashtra Stamp Act defines an instrument in an inclusive manner, as including every document. Hence, an instrument must be a document by which right or a liability is either created, transferred, extinguished, or recorded. So any of these 4 events taking place by virtue of a document would mean that that instrument, that is an instrument, and hence you need to then check whether it is governed under any of the articles under Schedule 1. What is excluded? And these are the 9 which fall under the purview of the Indian Stamp Act: a check, a share transfer form. That's a very important instrument, that transfer of shares in physical format, the green ledger format which we used to have, and several of us have not seen them because now we have only DMAT slips. But when you had physical shares and they were transferred, you had a share transfer form that attracts stamp duty under the Indian Stamp Act, not under the Maharashtra Stamp Act. A debenture issue, insurance policy, promissory note. So these are some of the 9 instruments governed under the central list. Instruments must be read as they are worded, nothing more and nothing less. So you cannot read into an instrument, you cannot read out of an instrument. Just as one of the statutory principles of interpretation says an act should be read as it is, similarly an instrument also should be read as it is. However, in certain cases, you may construe the true meaning by taking an overall perspective of the document. Now, what are the instruments where stamp duty is levied on market value? When you look at stamp duty, one of the other important considerations which you need to bear in mind is that some instruments attract stamp duty on the basis of market value. That's called an ad valorem basis, so as a percentage of the market value. And there are some instruments which attract on market value, some on flat rate. Now, which are those which attract on a market value? A conveyance, a scheme of a merger, demerger, reconstruct, and we are only looking at the Maharashtra Stamp Act, so I'm not looking at Indian or other stamp acts. In fact, the whole presentation, unless I say, is geared towards the Maharashtra Stamp Act only. A gift deed, a lease deed, or a leave and license in excess of 60 months, a transfer of a lease or a transfer of a tenancy, a surrender of a lease for consideration, a development rights agreement under which a builder gets the right to develop property without getting actual conveyance of the property, a power of attorney to sell property in certain cases. This has been one of the moves to prevent sale of immovable property on the basis of power of attorney. If you recall, The Supreme Court on several occasions, especially in the decisions of Suraj Lamp versus Union of India, has come down very heavily on sale of immovable property via power of attorney, a general power of attorney. And on that basis, a lot of black money and unaccounted money changes hands on the basis of just empowering a person to sell by way of a power of attorney. This also is prevalent, very common in Delhi and northern India, and not so much in Maharashtra. However, even the Maharashtra government has come out that if you were to sell property merely on the basis of power of attorney, whether with consideration or without consideration in certain cases, then it attracts stamp duty as on a conveyance, that is full stamp duty. Earlier it was used to only be a very nominal stamp duty. So that's been an amendment which has come out a few years ago, taking a cue from the Supreme Court decision in Suraj Lamp. Exchange of property, creation of a trust, a partition deed, a release deed. And we'll look at all of these in detail. So I'm just covering here which are the instruments which attract ad valorem. Partnership deed if capital is contributed by way of property. Dissolution of partnership and retirement if a partner takes away a property which he did not introduce into the partnership. Settlement, and it applies to both movable as well as immovable property. Another important basics of stamp duty, in whose name should the stamp paper be? So either party to the instrument. Although enough time has passed, yet we come across people saying, can I buy a stamp paper in the name of a chartered accountant or an advocate? Those are the days of yore, and now you need to buy it in the name of one of the parties to the instrument only. What amount to pay on ad valorem basis if the duty is attracted on the market value basis, else the duty as specified in the articles under Schedule 1 to the Maharashtra Stamp Act. Let's now look at conveyance which attracts maximum controversy, which is covered under Article 25 of the Schedule 1 and defined under Section 2G of the Act. So conveyance is defined to be an instrument by which property, estate or interest in property is transferred or vested in any other person inter vivos. Inter vivos means between living persons. So there must be a transfer or a vesting of property between two or more living persons inter vivos, that is what it means. Property may be movable or immovable. Both of them are covered within the purview of conveyance. And the instrument must not be covered within the scope of any other article under Schedule 1 to the Maharashtra Stamp Act. If it is, it cannot fall within the domain of a conveyance. If it is not, then it would be covered by a conveyance. Now, what are the rates for stamp duty? In case of movable, it is 3% of the value stated in the instrument. Because in case of a movable property, it is very important to know that under the Transfer of Property Act and under the Registration Act, it is not compulsory to have a conveyance for movable property. You can transfer a movable property by mere delivery and possession. So if I want to hand over this mic to someone in case of a sale, I can just hand it over, take the money and end of matter. I don't need a writing for that. However, if I were to make a conveyance saying I hereby bequeath my right, title and interest in this mic to you for a consideration of 100 rupees, then that agreement is treated as a conveyance and attracts stamp duty at 3% on the value stated in the instrument, that is 3% of 100 rupees. So you pay stamp duty of 3 rupees. So if you make an instrument for a movable property, you are bound to pay stamp duty. If you don't make an instrument and just transfer by delivery and possession, there is no stamp duty. So that's a very clear principle which we need to bear in mind, especially when we are doing itemized sales or slump sales of undertakings. If you are making a sale of only a movable undertaking, you may just have a letter of possession and an agreement to sale, and that would not attract stamp duty as on a conveyance, and we'll come to that when we look at it more in detail. Coming to immovable property, the very two same acts say, the Transfer of Property Act and the Registration Act, that if you want to transfer immovable property having a value of more than 100 rupees, so the threshold is only 100 rupees, then you do need a written instrument which must be registered. Therefore, if there is an instrument, automatically it is treated as a conveyance and you would then have to pay stamp duty as on a conveyance. Your properties in the state of Maharashtra are divided into three classes. Class A, and these class nomenclature are my doing, so it's not there in the Act. As for the ease of explaining, I'm saying Class A, that is the prime properties, attract stamp duty at 5%. Class B at 4%, and Class 3, which are rural properties, attract stamp duty as on a conveyance at 3%. earlier, that is still a couple of years ago, you had a concession for flat in a cooperative society. So the maximum stamp duty was 38,750 over a value of 10 lakhs. That has now been done away with, and now it is flat 5, 4 or 3 depending upon where the flat is, whether it is in a cooperative society, whether it is in a land or whether it's a bungalow. So that concessional rate has been done away with. Next, we need to look at what is the property. Is it movable or immovable? So as I said, movable property can be transferred by delivery and possession, no instrument required. Immovable property, necessary to have an instrument if it is more than 100 rupees. Now, if it is something like a flat in a society or if it is land and building, very easy to define whether it is movable or immovable. But how do you distinguish in the case of plant and machinery or similar things which may have the color of movable and immovable? Now, if you look at the immovable property definition in the Maharashtra Stamp Act, it says includes land and everything attached to earth, whereas the General Clauses Act says it includes land and benefits arising out of land. So not a very clear-cut definition, giving only an inclusive manner of a definition, and does not throw much light on grey area cases as to plant and machinery, whether they would be treated as movable or would they be treated as immovable. There are some Supreme Court decisions which have thrown a lot of light on them. Important amongst them are three: Duncan Agro, Triveni Engineering and Sirpur Paper Mills. If you look at the gist of all these three decisions, what they say is that if something is embedded in the earth and if by removing it you are damaging its substratum or you are damaging its value or you are reducing its value, then it is immovable property. But if it which is attached to earth, and if you can merely remove it and sell it without reducing its value, it is movable property. Now, may sound a little difficult to digest, but let's look at two examples which will clarify it. Say a chemical plant or a gas refinery. Embedded in the earth, if you go to remove a chemical plant, if you go to remove gas refinery, you will damage the value of the plant and machinery. That is immovable property. Transferring a chemical plant requires a registered instrument of and would attract stamp duty as on a conveyance of immovable property. However, a paper plant, which is merely affixed by nuts and bolts to something so as to prevent vibration while it is in operation, remove them, put it on a lorry and transport it. That is a movable property because you are not damaging the substratum when you remove the paper plant from the earth. So if it is embedded, if it is damaged, it becomes immovable. If it does not, and you can sell it without reducing the value, without damaging substratum, it is movable. This distinction is very useful, not just duty, also in excise, also in VAT, because it forms a very fundamental difference as to what is movable and what is immovable, and a lot of laws depend upon the movability or the immovability of an asset. Now, explanation 1 to Article 25, which is the article dealing with conveyance, also says that if you are in agreement to sell an immovable property, then you are deemed to be a conveyance. So merely entering into an agreement to sell immovable property tantamounts to a conveyance, whether you give possession under that agreement or later on. So it is not necessary that just because you say I agree to sell you this flat and I will give you possession in future and I will execute a conveyance in future, it goes out of the stamp duty purview. It attracts stamp duty today as if it were a conveyance. When you were subsequently you will execute the conveyance, you will get a set off for the stamp duty which you have already paid. So this was a major amendment which came in several years ago, and now it's the law of the land. But it only attracts to immovable property, not to movable property. So you cannot extend the fiction given under stamp law for explanation 1 to anything other than immovable property. Further, the explanation does not apply for any purpose other than stamp duty. It only applies for stamp duty, does not create an interest in property, does not do anything further. For instance, if you look at Section 54 of the Transfer of Property Act, there is a distinction between an agreement to sell and a conveyance. An agreement to sell does not create a right or an interest of the buyer in the property. It is only an agreement. It is only a conveyance which creates a right or an interest of the person in the property. So this is a fundamental difference. Because of the explanation, stamp law has been modified, not the general law. But there has been an important amendment this year in the Maharashtra Stamp Act. It says set off for conveyance would only be allowed if registered agreement to sale has been executed and stamp duty has been paid on the registered agreement to sale. Prior to 2013, it was set off for conveyance only if agreement to sale was executed. So now the stamp office wants that even the agreement to sale must be registered and only then you will get a set off for what you paid under the agreement to sale. Let's look at an example. There was an agreement to sell in 2007 on which you paid stamp duty at 10 lakhs. Now you are executing a conveyance in 2013 and stamp duty on this conveyance based on today's reckoner is 30 lakhs. Would excess duty be payable on the entire 30 or would it be you get a set off of the 20? Here it says the agreement to sale must be registered. Now it was not registered then. So according to this amendment, you will have to pay again on the entire. Now this is an incorrect assumption that agreement to sell must be registered. If you look at the Bombay High Court decision in Naginbhai Desai versus Sarabhai and Sheikh, it says that the deeming fiction under explanation 1 to article 25 only applies for the purposes of stamp duty under the Maharashtra Stamp Act. Registration is not required for an agreement to sell. To that extent, the Bombay High Court has said registration is not required because an agreement to sell does not create a right, does not create an interest of the buyer in the property. Now, in spite of this, the registration department has gone ahead and issued, the government has gone ahead and issued this amendment, which in my view is totally wrong and incorrect. And it's only a matter of time before somebody files a public interest litigation or challenges the ultra-vires nature of this amendment. And it should not see the light of day very soon. But this is what the law is currently after the amendment. Another important and draconian amendment made by the registration department is that a deed of confirmation which is unilaterally executed will no longer be valid for the purposes of stamp duty. Means you'll have to pay stamp duty again. Now let me explain the background to this. What used to happen earlier is that you entered into a transaction a few years ago, but you've not registered it. You may have paid proper stamp duty on it, but you didn't register it for any reason whatsoever. Today you want to register it, but both the parties are not available to register the document. So what we used to do is we would prepare a deed of confirmation where one of the parties who wants to register it goes to the registrar and confirms that I annexed the document which I had executed then. I have validly paid stamp duty on it. Please register this by taking this registration fees. End of matter. What the circular now says, if the time limit for registration is 4 plus 4 months extension under the Registration Act, so total of 8 months. So if you have not registered the document within a period of 8 months of execution, then pay stamp duty today based on the current fair market value and not the FMV prevailing when the original agreement was executed. Even if you had validly paid stamp duty at that point of time, you are again asked to pay stamp duty today based on today's reckoner value. So conveyance executed in 2010, stamp duty properly paid based on then prevailing reckoner, 5 lakh rupees. Registered today by way of a deed of confirmation, pay stamp and reckoner value is 15. Pay differential duty also on the registration today. Now this is again has created a lot of problems for several old documents where the builders, etc. had not registered the agreement. If you go to register them today, you face the differential stamp duty again. And the registrar has justified his position by coming out with another detailed circular explaining it by relying on a Supreme Court decision by saying that the two agreements are different because what was then done and what is done today are two agreements which are different in law and hence you are bound to pay stamp duty today. Now here you must pause and just also appreciate that it is not that all deeds of confirmation are invalid. It is only unilateral deed of confirmation which attracts differential stamp duty. If both the parties come forward and execute a deed of confirmation, then correctly speaking, it should be as per the current stamp duty, but within the period of 8 months. So if you, within 8 months, what you did 8 months ago and come and execute a deed of confirmation with both parties, then there should not be again any stamp duty. It is only the registration fees which it would be attracted. And if you look at the explanatory circular of the registrar, it says so to that effect. Although it is entirely in Marathi, And I had the good fortune of a friend, Mr. Pandit, who translated it very painstakingly for me. So, based on what I read from the Marathi as well as his interpretation, it's only for, it does not say all deeds of confirmation are invalid. And that is a view being taken by several people in the registration department, that all deeds are invalid for confirmation, whether within 8 months or beyond 8 months. A change of name. Now, this is something which sounds quite innocuous, but it has created a lot of problem. And if you would appreciate it, went all the way to the Supreme Court. There was a lessee who was in garment business, and there was a restrictive covenant in the deed that he will not carry on any other business. The business was changed to IT Park. With the lessor's consent, the restrictive covenant was relaxed, and they changed the name to reflect the new line of activity. The stamp office demanded stamp duty as on a fresh lease agreement, saying this is change of entity and change of restrictive covenant, and therefore you need to pay stamp duty as on a fresh lease document. Supreme Court in Prasad Technology Park held that this is not a fresh lease deed, it is only a change of name. The entity has also not changed. It is only the name of the entity which has changed, and therefore fresh stamp duty is not payable once again. But this I have seen in several cases, even in flat in a cooperative society, when names are being changed of partnership firms or companies, they are demanding stamp duty again. Entirely wrong. You may rely on this Supreme Court decision to keep the demand at bay. Exchange deeds are quite common, especially in buildings in Mumbai. You have somebody who has a flat of a smaller size who wants to exchange it with somebody who has a flat of a bigger size. Do you pay stamp duty twice or do you pay stamp duty once? Answer is, exchange is a barter. So one person gives up something in return for another. And if you look at the transfer of property, here again it throws light. The difference between exchange and sale is that in sale, the consideration is always money. In exchange, it is something else. So where there is a barter of exchange, where there is a barter, it's an exchange. Where the consideration is money, it is sale. There is absence of monetary consideration. Stamp duty is leviable on the property of higher FMB because the exchange takes place through one deed. So you say under one deed that I give up my flat 105 having a value of 1 crore in lieu of flat 205 having a value of 2 crore. And all of this takes, and vice versa. And both of these take place through one deed of exchange. So stamp duty would be at 5% on the FMB of the property of higher value, so that is 2 crores. So 5% on 2 crores, 10 lakhs. So you don't pay stamp duty twice, both on 2 plus 1. You pay only on 2, on the higher of the two values. Lease deeds have undergone a lot of changes. Article 36 has seen a lot of, you know, back and forth. Now the position is that a lease tenure up to 5 years attracts duty at 0.5% of the FMV of property. 5 to 10, 1.25. 10 to 29, 2.5%. 29 years plus up to perpetuity, 4.5% of the FMV of property. Now, I've given the above rates only for Class A properties. If there would be Class B and Class C, there is a reduction of 20% and 40% in the rates which I have mentioned. For simplicity, I have given it in a simplistic manner. Now, a question arises that if it is a monthly tenancy, and that's very popular, which we see a month-to-month tenancy, then what is the stamp duty? Which tenure do I fall in? Is it 5 years or is it perpetuity? Here, there are several decisions which have said it is stamp duty as on a perpetual lease. So Skinner versus Arunachalam and several Bombay High Court decisions have held that if no definite term for the lease or if month to month, then treat it as a perpetual tenancy or a perpetual lease and pay stamp duty on that basis. So very important to bear in mind that if it is month to month or if it is perpetual, then you treat it as perpetual, not as a 29 year or a 5 year or a 10 year. Now, transfer of lease. Till a couple of years ago, we had a differential stamp duty under Article 5 for transfer of tenancy and Article 60 for transfer of lease, as if the two terms meant something else in law. So our Maharashtra Stamp Act distinguished between lease on one hand and tenancy on the other hand as both being separate in the eyes of law. But if you look at the Transfer of Property Act, which is the mother statute for all immovable property transactions, there is no difference in that. Now realizing that distinction, they have neutralized it, to say after 2011 that if it is a residential property less than 300 square feet, then there is a concessional stamp duty on transfer of a lease or on transfer of a tenancy. However, if it is a larger property and a non-residential property, then stamp duty as on a conveyance at 5%, 4% or 3%. On the other hand, in case of a transfer of a lease under Article 60, flat stamp duty as on a conveyance 5, 4 or 3. So now the concessional stamp duty on transfer of a tenancy, which used to be on a per square meter of area transferred. So depending on the area transferred, the stamp duty was fixed. That has gone away and now we are only at FMV at 5, 4 or 3. So class A, B or C properties. Leave and license agreement, again back to 10 years. If it is not exceeding 60 months with or without renewal, then it is 0.25% of the total of three items, the license fees and the rent, non-refundable security deposit and premium charge, and interest at 10% on the security deposit. So notional interest is attributed. So just as in house property income taxation, as all of us would appreciate, the department has been attributing notional interest on the security deposit. Similarly, stamp office has now made it part of the law and you have notional interest 10% on the security deposit, whether charged or not. On that, you pay stamp duty at 0.25%. If it exceeds 60 months tenure in case of a leave and license agreement, then it is back to Article 36. This is in 36A. So you go back to Article 36 as on a lease deed and you pay as per 5, 10, 29 or perpetuity. Now, what is a leave and license and what is a lease has often been a matter of debate in several Supreme Court decisions like ICICI, Associated Hotels, R.N. Kapoor. The common thread which you may draw from these decisions is that a lease creates an interest in a property, whereas a license is a personal right under the Easement Act. So if it is not creating an interest, if it is a personal right, then it is a license. But if it is creating a transferable interest, if it is creating a right in the property, then it is a lease. That's one way to look at it. However, in most cases of leave and license, you may be able to decipher whether it is lease or license. But in some cases, like in case of the Bandra Kurla leases, and that's the ICICI Supreme Court decision, there the Supreme Court had an occasion to consider whether the lease or the license by MMRDA to ICICI was a lease or a license, and they have looked at all of these factors, whether it created interest or not. So it's more fact-based under the principles of the overall law. Now, one important provision which we need to bear in mind is execution of instruments outside the state. If you execute any instrument pertaining to properties situated in Maharashtra and wherever you may execute it, then you would generally pay stamp duty as per the law prevailing in that state where you executed it. However, if you bring back the instrument or even a copy thereof into the state of Maharashtra, then the copy or the instrument, whichever is brought back, is liable to be stamped with differential stamp duty. And the stamp office or any public officer has power to impound it. A very interesting decision in the case of Anti-Friction Bearing Corporation, Bombay High Court. Here, it was a company whose registered office was in Maharashtra, but they had a lot of immovable property in Gujarat. They set up a debenture trust deed in Gujarat and they appointed one of the public financial institutions as the trustee of that debenture trust deed in Gujarat. They paid stamp duty as per the Gujarat law. However, being a company whose registered office was in Maharashtra, they filed a copy of that with the ROC under the Companies Act of 1956. The copy got impounded on the grounds that this is a copy liable to stamp duty with differential duty. It was argued before the Bombay High Court that it is not within the jurisdiction of the state to levy stamp duty on a copy because it is not the original which has come into the state, it is only a copy. However, the Bombay High Court set aside this objection saying it is within the powers of the state to levy stamp duty even on a copy. So even a copy is liable to stamp duty with the differential. And this becomes quite an important point to be borne in mind because several people nowadays have a fancy for executing agreements in Delhi, Hyderabad and similar places where stamp duty is at a pittance as of now. So then you try and get away with the stamp law which is applicable in Maharashtra. But would a copy even come into the state? And if the auditor were to ask for it, or if the income tax department were to ask for it, the ITO is empowered to impound it and give it onwards to the registrar or the collector of stamps for proper payment of stamp duty. So that's something which we need to bear in mind while executing transactions outside the state of Maharashtra. And this is governed by Section 19 of the Maharashtra Stamp Act. Now, let's look at stamp duty and business restructuring, because there's a lot of fodder for business restructuring when it comes to stamp duty. Before that, I'd just like to touch upon one of the points which Ashok Bhai asked. What about a letter of allotment? Does it attract stamp duty? Now, if you generally look at the letters of allotment issued by builders in Maharashtra, none of them carry any stamp duty. And they do not even ask the buyer to pay. But the correct position is it a letter of intended allotment or is it a letter of confirmed allotment? We must distinguish between these two. If it is a letter of intended allotment, where the builder says that the allotment is tentative, I am giving you a flat on 24th floor or thereabouts. The flat number is also not certain because my plans have not yet been approved. And this is subject to cancellation and modification, then it is not an offer, it is not an acceptance, it is not an agreement, and it does not attract stamp duty. There is no article in the Maharashtra Stamp Act governing letter of allotment for a flat. There is an article for governing letter of allotment for shares in a company. So if you are giving a letter of allotment for shares in a company, there is a specific article. But there is no specific article for letter of allotment in a flat or for a flat. Therefore, letter of intended allotment, in my view, no stamp duty. But then you come to the next stage, you go on to a letter of confirmed allotment, when the LOIA materializes into LOCA. In the LOCA, I say my plan, they've been approved, I give you a flat on 24th floor, they're in flat number 2402, and you are required to make payment. Now, this constitutes an offer by the builder, and when accepted by the buyer, it constitutes an agreement. And if it constitutes an agreement to sell, it attracts stamp duty as under explanation 1, to that is on a conveyance. Practically happens, this is the correct legal position, but what practically happens is that the builder says that I would be executing a MOSA agreement. Maharashtra Ownership Flat Act of 63 within a period of 20 to 30 days on which you would be required to pay stamp duty. Therefore, in essence, LOCA also does not attract stamp duty. However, correctly, if the MOFA agreement were not executed, it is an agreement which attracts stamp duty. And recently, in 2012, there has been a Bombay High Court decision in Sushil Shivdasani versus Air In Private Limited. There, the question before the Bombay High Court was, does a letter of confirmed allotment constitute an agreement? And the High Court said yes, because it is an offer and an acceptance, it does constitute an agreement. One of the pleas raised by the counsel for the builder was that even if it constitutes an agreement, it is not a MOFA agreement because it does not contain the clauses as required under the Maharashtra Flat Ownership Act. Bombay High Court said that's a violation which you may have done. That does not take away the essence of it being an agreement. So it is an agreement. And therefore, my reading, it would attract stamp duty. However, practically, because the MOFA agreement is executed within a short duration of 2 to 3 weeks, you don't pay stamp duty on a letter of allotment. Now, let us look at business restructuring and stamp duty. I was just mentioning to one of the participants that now income tax law is more or less, and I say more or less, and I'm sure you all would be ready to disagree with me, settled, or to some extent we have some direction when it comes to restructuring, that we have provisions in the Act. There may be grey areas, definitely, but when it comes to stamp duty, it's every man's interpretation for himself. So the person on the field, and that's where the slip between the cup and the lip often comes in business restructuring. What we will see here is often what has not happened on ground reality. And many times what I've seen is that business decisions of restructuring, which are often good, are made or marred by virtue of a restructuring decision because of stamp duty. One of the Jindal mergers was converted into a reverse merger because of the heavy stamp duty incident, while other laws were favorable for a forward merger. let us first look at stamp duty on a merger, which has always been an evergreen issue, not so much now under the Maharashtra Stamp Act, but definitely yet under other states of India. Now, the conveyance definition under 2G defines a conveyance to include every instrument, every decree or order of a civil court, and every high court order under 394 of the Companies Act, or an RBI order under the Banking Regulation Act for amalgamation or reconstruction of companies. So, Section 2G of the Maharashtra Stamp Act is very clear that any court order under 394 for restructuring or for amalgamation is treated as a conveyance. Article 25DA of the Schedule 1 then goes on to say that stamp duty as on a court-approved scheme would be 10% of the market value of the shares issued plus any other consideration paid, but not exceeding the higher of the two values, 5% of the market value of immovable property of the transferor located within the state of Maharashtra, or 0.7% of the market value of the shares issued. We need to consider these three limits very clearly. They are not cumulative. They are not highest of the two. It says 10% is the overall charging section, not exceeding higher of the two. So 10% is attracted in those cases when the 5% of the market value of immovable property is higher than 10% of the market value of shares. I'll explain it with an illustration, then it will become clearer. And for determining the market value of immovable property, one needs to go by the ready reckoner value. Further, in addition to this, on issue of share certificates under Article 17, you pay 0.1% stamp duty also. Now, let us look at the three scenarios when each of the three slabs would be attracted. Let's look at scenario 1 first. The fair market value of shares is 1,000, immovable property is 3,000. So, now you work out stamp duty under each of the clauses.